We're talking about being the light before we're going to share the light. So tonight, our topic is the city of worship, be the light. City of worship, be the light. The Bible says in John chapter 1, verse 5, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness, no darkness at all. God is light. John chapter 8, verse 12 says, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. So God is light, and Jesus is light. But then the scripture that the local church and Brother Daniel have selected for this convention tells us that you are the light of the world. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. You are the light of the world. See, God is light and Jesus is light. But the Bible also tells us that you are the light of the world. And this is where we come in. So it's a very, very important topic this weekend. We all better pay attention. We all better learn. We all better take the word that's being preached up here and deposit it deeply in our hearts. You are the light of the world, Jesus said. And when he said you're the light of the world, you are not the light for yourself. It says in Acts chapter 13, verse 47, I have placed you as a light for the Gentiles that you may bring salvation to the end of the earth. You are not a light for yourself. You are a light for the people around you. And that's the message this weekend. God is light. Jesus is light. You are the light, but you're not a light for yourself. You're a light for the people God placed you with. The people God placed around you. You know, the first thing that God created was what? Anybody know? The light. Genesis chapter 1 verse 3. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And it says, and God saw that the light was good. The light was good. So tonight we're talking about a city of worship. Or be the light through worship. A city of worship. Be the light through worship. When talking about worship, most of the young people think about that period of 20, 30 minutes on Sunday morning before the pastor preaches. And that's worship. That's what they believe that worship is all about. Tonight, my job is to talk about the many other types of worship, many other ways we can worship God. I know that music, and Brother Alex has talked about music and the way the angels in heaven are worshiping God. And like I said, many people think that worship is limited to it only includes worship. And what I want to say, worship is limited when it only includes worship. There are many, many other kinds of worship, many, many other ways to worship God. Music, and I love music. I was a musician myself for many, many years. I was singing in Grupo Omega. Those of you who are a little bit older maybe remember. So I love music myself. But music is not the only way to worship. And I think that we limit worship when it only includes music. There are many, many other ways to worship God, and music is not the only way to worship God, and it should not be the only way to worship God. I hope I didn't just ruin it for everybody. There's many other ways to worship. In theology, there's a law called the law of first mention. The law of first mention. And what this means is that every time you read the Bible and you first read a word, a key word, an important word, the law of first mention means that God, when God introduces or mentions something for the very first time in the Bible, you better pay close attention because he defines its properties very clearly so you can understand what that term means. So every time you read your Bible and you read about blood or sacrifice or spirit or worship, in our case tonight, you go to the very first time that God has mentioned that word in the Bible, and this law of first mention will tell you very, very important things about that specific subject. When you first read about worship in the Bible, you better pay close attention because God is trying to tell you something very important about that thing. That's this law, the law of first mention. Now, and then you begin a pattern and you learn more and more as you read throughout the Bible. But the first time you read it, it's important. Now, tonight we're talking about worship. And we're going to go to the first time the Bible mentions this word in the Bible. It's Genesis chapter 22 and verse 5. And you know the story. The story of Abraham and Isaac. You know the story how Abraham couldn't have children for many, many years. God promises a son. And when he's very old, he finally is blessed by the Lord with the son. And this is where God is calling him to go and sacrifice his son. You know the story. We're going to be speaking from this story tonight. So pay attention with me. We're going to learn something. This is the first time the word worship is mentioned in the Bible. Abraham said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship." Everybody say, "We will worship." Oh, come on, you can do better than that. "We will worship." All right. "We will worship and then we will come back to you." This is the first time in the Bible where we read this word, worship. And the law of first mention tells us that every time you read it for the first time, now of course as you read it in other places, God still teaches us things about that particular subject. But the first time, you better pay attention because it's important. I have a few questions about this verse. Question number one. How did Abraham worship? He had no band. He had no musical instruments. Nowhere we read that he pulled out his accordion. Come on now. Sho scos acordeonul. Hai să ne închinăm. He didn't practice before. He didn't have a drummer. He didn't have the beautiful lights and all the guitars. And look at this effect pedals. Man, look, nice. Praise the Lord. Amen. He worshiped. You mean he can worship without all this stuff? Yeah, I guess so. That's what it says. We will worship. What was the worship? Was simply a meeting with God in the presence of his son Isaac. A meeting with God. That was his worship. Another very important thing for you to know from this passage. Worship was first a spiritual act before it was a physical act. Worship was before a physical act, it was a spiritual act. Abraham has to sacrifice his son before in his heart and then to do it physically. Come on, somebody. Abraham, you gotta do the sacrifice before in your heart, before you actually do it. His worship is a spiritual act before it becomes a physical act. Come on, stay with me. So many times we do it the other way and we're stuck with the physical part. Before Abraham can grab the knife and be ready to sacrifice to God physically, he's got to do it in his heart. That's where the worship begins. Come on. That's where the fight is going on. That's where the battle happens, in the heart. You got to sacrifice in your heart before you actually do it physically. Oh, and how many of us just do it physically so people can see it, so the youth can go, man, ce fain or cântat ăștia de la Chicago. You know? Worship is always a spiritual act before it is a physical act. Next. After it is a spiritual act, worship is always and has to be a physical act. Also, it's got to be visible. Because now we go to the other extreme. We're talking about spiritual and physical now. Some people just do it physical, never spiritual. Some people just do it spiritual and never physical. Come on. Nu vreau să mă vadă nimeni că I'm praising the Lord, you know. God knows my heart. I worship him there. At church, God, you know I'm worshiping you. Worship has to first be a spiritual act, but then it has to be a physical act. It has to be. The time comes when you gotta grab the knife physically and bring the sacrifice. And grab that guitar and praise the Lord physically. It's visible. Amen. You can't just be satisfied with the spirit. God, I'm just going to stay. What do you think? If Abraham never went to the mountain, but sacrificed Isaac only in his heart. God, you know my heart. Oh, he's all sacrificed. He dead. He gone. Mm-hmm. He no longer my son. He's with his mama, you know. No, the time comes when you got to do it physically. So it's got two parts, spiritual and physical, and you gotta do it right. You start with the spiritual, but then you do it physically also. Worship is visible. You can't say, oh, God knows my heart. Yeah, he knows your heart, but he wants you to worship physically. Worship was a sacrifice. Worship was a sacrifice. Very important point. Imagine what a worship is without sacrifice. Worship is a sacrifice. There's a very important detail here that if we don't read it carefully, we will just kind of read over it and we'll never actually notice it. I'm going to read the verse again. Abraham said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. And then he said, we will worship. Everybody say, we will worship. Oh, come on, say it louder than that. We will worship. Question for you. Who is we? Abraham and Isaac. It doesn't say, I will worship. It says, we will worship. That means that Abraham is not the only one who's worshiping. Isaac is worshiping also. Isaac worshiped on top of that mountain. How did Abraham worship? Well, he was going to sacrifice his son. He was going to bring a sacrifice. And watch this. You got to get this. You got to get this. That's how Abraham worshiped. How did Isaac worship? Because he says, we will worship. You know how he worshiped? He was being sacrificed. Sometimes you worship God when you worship and bring a sacrifice, and that's Abraham. Sometimes you worship God when you are being sacrificed. That's a little too heavy for some of you tonight. I know you're tired. Worship is a deep act before God. It's not always fun, and it's not always to the drum beat. Come on, give me a drum roll. Isaac worshiped how? He was going to be sacrificed. Sometimes, my young friend, you are worshiping God while you're being sacrificed. You lose the fight you're in, and everybody's looking at you like a loser. But you are worshiping God while you're being sacrificed. Abraham brings the sacrifice. Isaac is being sacrificed. And they both worship. We will worship. Now I know it's not Christmas, but I'm going to read a passage from New Testament. When in the New Testament it's mentions this word. Matthew chapter 2 verse 1 and 2 real quickly. It talks about the wise men. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. That's you're talking about a sacrifice. They traveled just like some of us travel all the way here. It was a sacrifice. It cost money. They came to Jerusalem. Verse 2, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. They made a sacrifice. It cost money. It took them out of their comfort zone. Verse 11. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother. And then he says, watch this. They got out their guitars and started to worship the Lord. Amen. Is that what it says? Now, don't get me wrong. Again, huge part of our worship is music. But my job tonight is to talk about the fact that music is not the only type of worship. He says, when they saw the child, they fell down and they worship. They bow down and they worship him. They gave gifts to him. It doesn't say anywhere that they started to sing. We'll go back to Abraham now. Back to Abraham. For Abraham and Isaac, worship was a place of testing. You know that sometimes you can worship God in the middle of your trial, in the middle of your problem. Worship was a test for Abraham. Somebody said, never was any gold tried in such hot fire. Abraham is being tested and he is worshiping God. Worship was an act of obedience. Both Abraham and Isaac worship God. And the Bible says here, I love how it says it. He says, he rose early in the morning that day. I would have slept in until 12 o'clock. And then at 12, I would have said, I'm going to stay 2-3 more hours in bed. I don't want to go to the mountain. Abraham woke up early in the morning. And he began his sad 3-day journey. 3 days they traveled. Do you imagine this? I'm sure they talked. Father and son, Abraham and Isaac, traveling for 3 days. We're going to worship God. What do you say to your son for 3 days walking? We're going to worship. Dad, where is the animal? Oh, don't worry. God will provide. It was an act of obedience. He obeyed God because worship, listen to me, worship without obedience equals zero. Zero. Worship without obedience equals zero. Worship was a holy sacrifice, and worship is always a holy sacrifice. If it's not holy, you may call it worship, but it's not. Worship has to be holy. Let me read a few verses. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 27. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination. If you are wicked, God don't care about your worship. That's what it says there. But Brother Adi, we practiced for 2 months. You know, we're coming, we're going to the convention. Worship has to be a holy sacrifice. Genesis chapter 4, verse 3 and 4. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought, now you got to watch this, that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. So Cain brings a sacrifice to the Lord. Verse 4, Abel, you know the story of Cain and Abel, these two brothers. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And listen to what it says next. And the Lord accepted what or who? It says, again, we got to read the scripture and pay attention to what it says. It does not say, look at the order here. The order is important. It says, and the Lord accepted. It doesn't say he's offering an Abel. It says that the Lord accepted first Abel and then his offering. The Lord always looks at a person first and then looks at the offering. I don't care how great your offering is. If there is sin in your life, the Lord looked at Abel and accepted Abel, and because accepted Abel, then he also accepted his offering. There's a very, very important order here. God looks at the person first and then looks at the act of the offering. We don't like this. I don't like it either. God wants us to be holy and acceptable before him so that our worship can be acceptable. Worship is the acceptance of worship is conditional. Now, I know that the worship is for God, and we've heard about that. And I know that every knee shall bow and every tongue will. I mean, I looked today in the city. I was walking a little bit, and I saw all these millions of, 8.5 million people live here. And I know that every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. The good and the bad will worship him one day, but I want to be the righteous one. I want to be in the righteous crowd. I want to be numbered among those who worship God here before, not just on the last day. God looks at you before he looks at your worship. God looks at you before he looks at your offering. God looks at you before he looks at your cute little song that you sing in your church. He does. He really does. God looks at the man first and then looks at the offering. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. Everybody say, worship God acceptably. Eh? Do it one more time. You're doing good. Worship God acceptably. Do you know what this tells me? That there is a way to worship God that is not acceptable to him. That's what it, not every worship is accepted. If every worship was accepted, this verse would not be in the Bible. Oh, let's just go and worship God. What, great. And again, I'm not preaching works tonight. We're not preaching salvation tonight, okay? We're preaching worship. I believe that I'm talking with a bunch, a crowd of people who have been saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And after you've been saved, God is expecting something from you. If we were talking about salvation, we're not talking works here tonight. But we're talking about saved people worshiping their Creator and their Savior. Hallelujah. It's got to be acceptable. How is it acceptable? When you worship with reverence and in awe. Next, I want to answer a question that I'm sure all of you have. Most of you know the answer, but I want to just recap it tonight. Where does worship come from? Where does worship come from? Some people think that it comes from your gift. If worship comes from your gift, we have a problem. Anybody knows what it is? Only gifted people will be able to worship, right? If worship comes from your gift, only gifted people could worship. Now, I know everybody's gifted in their own way, but worship does not come from the gift. The Bible says, John chapter 7:38, that it comes from your spirit. He says here, he that believeth on me, as the scripture had said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living waters. Now, the term belly here is a metaphor. It does not mean your stomach. If it means your stomach, then only fat people would be able to worship God. And we know that, oh, fat people can worship God. Praise the Lord, you know. Why not? But it's a metaphor. Some other translations say, out of your heart shall flow rivers of living water. Dinini mata. It comes from the inside. It comes from your spirit. It comes from the inside, from your heart. Your heart is the fountain. Your heart is the well. And if in your well there's a lot of garbage and dirt and mud and sin and lust and jealousy and hate, you tell me what kind of water comes out of there. Dirty water. Stinky water, not accepted water, not accepted worship. You know, there's a lot of noise in many of our churches today. There's a lot of noise, there's a lot of excitement in some of our youth meetings. There's a lot of energy. It's a lot of talent. I'm sorry, but you could get that in a club. I never been to a club, but I'm sure you could get it there. energy, excitement, noise. Worship goes deeper than that. You step into a spiritual act. It comes from your heart and it goes directly before the Lord. That's why it's important how we worship and who is the person that worships. And I'm going to repeat myself here again. We've heard Brother Alex say that worship is all about God. And I talked to him before tonight. We talked together what he's going to preach about and what I'm going to preach about. And we kind of talked with each other. And his job was to talk about the God part of worship. And that's true. Worship is about God. And many times, and most of the times, we're not worthy. But I want to talk a little bit about the person who worships, because that's important too. And what kind of person is it that comes before the Lord to bring the sacrifice? And like I said, worship is not just music. There are many other aspects of worship. I don't have time to go into it real quickly. I'm just going to give you a few examples for those of you who are not musicians. You are not, just because you didn't make it to the stage tonight doesn't mean that you're not a worshiper. Come on. Music is not the only way to worship God. Let me give you quickly some examples, some of the many other ways to worship without music. Worship through prayer. Did you know that you can worship God through your prayer? Now, I know that not all of you can play guitar. But all of you can pray. Amen. Worship is a prayer is a type of worship. And you can worship God through your prayer. Everybody knows the Lord's Prayer, right? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. In other words, our Father who is in heaven, may your name be honored. In other translations, our Father, you are in heaven, may your name be honored. That was the Lord's Prayer. I see him worshiping here. Prayer can be an act of worship before you. And let me tell you something. In many, many churches and many, many young people want to sing their way into heaven instead of crawling your way into heaven on your knees in prayer. And we have replaced in many of our youth services the time of prayer with the time of worship. Nothing wrong with the time of worship, but everything wrong with the time of worship when we play for 45 minutes music with all kinds of instruments and we pray 1 minute. Where's the balance in our youth services? Where is it? Worshiping God through prayer. Reading your Bible is an act of worship. You know, Jesus said to the woman, the true worshipers will worship God in spirit and in truth. How are you going to know the truth if you don't know the Bible, if you don't read the Bible? And oh, we can talk tonight a lot about Bible illiteracy. We have a bunch of young people who never read their Bible anymore. Most of you don't even have a Bible because you got an app on your phone now. Nothing wrong with your Bible app phone if you read it, except you can't really take notes on it. Well, you can kind of highlight things now, I know. You can worship God in truth only when you know the truth. That's the Bible right there. Oh, it's a lot easier to sing a song. I know that. Than to pray and then to read the word. Worshiping God through giving. Matthew chapter 6 verse 28. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You can worship God when you give. It's an act of worship. Next, worshiping God through going to church. Did you know that church attendance is an act of worship before God? Somebody say amen. You can worship God when you go to church. It's an act of worship. It's called church attendance. You go. You go to church, you worship God. Not just at concerts, not just at youth conferences. Going to church, serving others. Matthew chapter 25, verse 40, the king will reply, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brethren of mine, you did it for me. Every time you help somebody, brother or sister, you help Jesus. That's what it says. It is an act. Oh, brother, but I don't play guitar. Yes, but you can help somebody, a brother or sister in need that God has brought in front of you. And when you help that person financially or in any other way, it's an act of worship before God. Sharing your faith, we're going to hear about it tomorrow. It's an act of worship. Obeying God, we talked about obeying God. Worship is so many things. And it can be so many things besides music. Now, I know music is a wonderful part of our services. I'm not putting music down. The Psalms are full of music, full of musical instruments. I love it. But let's not limit worship to music only. If you're not a musician, that's okay. That's okay. You can still worship God. I want to close. I want to read a few more verses. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters. This verse is not just for brothers and not just for sisters. For both, brothers and sisters. In view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. Everybody say, holy and pleasing to God. You're doing very good. That's, again, a key phrase there. In order for worship to be pleasing to God, it's got to be what? I didn't write this. It's right there in your Bible. Holy and pleasing to God. Not every worship is pleasing to God. But if it is holy, it comes from a person who is trying. I mean, we're not talking about perfect people here. Man, if you needed to be perfect to worship, none of us. I put the mic down right now. I'll be the first one. And again, I'm not preaching works here. But we're talking about worship. We're talking about saved people who are worshiping God. Come on. Be holy as I am holy. I'm trying every day. I know I fall short, but I'm trying my best now that I've been saved through grace, right? This is your true and proper worship. Remember when I say proper worship? Come on, say it. I love it. You sound so good. Say it again, just for me. Proper worship. Proper worship. Hallelujah. You know what that means? Some worship is not proper. If every worship was proper, it wouldn't say proper worship. It would just say worship. No, some worship is not proper. But some worship is proper. Proper worship. True and proper worship. Verse 14 talks about blameless people and pure people, children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation. Shine like a star in the universe. We're talking about being the light through worship. Now, in closing, I said that again before. You're tired. I'm tired too. But man, it's so good to be in the presence of God and to learn from the Bible and to worship God with these wonderful young people who have traveled from all over the country to worship God together. You know, this is awesome. Not because I'm preaching, and it's not about a single person here. It's because we are all together worshiping the Lord, learning from the Word of God, seeing one another, asking your brother and sister, how you doing? How's your life? How you been doing? I haven't seen you in a long time. Fellowship. Awesome. I love you guys. All right, I want to read in closing. Philippians chapter 2, verse 17. Apostle Paul says, this is at the end of his life, but even if I am being poured as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service. He talks here about being poured as a drinking offering. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. Apostle Paul here is at the end of his life. And he's saying, I'm ready. I like the first part where it says, for I am ready. I'm already being poured like a drink offering. He's making here a comparison that's very, very interesting. He's saying, I am like a drink offering before the Lord. There are many, many verses and passages in the Bible where people have brought before the Lord drink offerings. Jacob poured oil on the stone when he wanted to honor God. And there's many places, like I said, in the Old Testament when people brought before the Lord a drink offering. And Paul is saying here at the end of his life, I am ready to be poured out as a drink offering before the Lord. Now, I know that some of you are tired tonight, and I don't want to make a show here. But I wanted to make an illustration that you will probably remember. So I brought with me something that I want to try to use. All right, let's see if this works, okay? Just stay with me. All right. We're talking about a drink offering. How many of you love Pepsi? No? I don't know about you, but I'm very thirsty. So I'm gonna, if you don't mind. Oh man, this is good. All right. So we're talking, thank you. You can come at the end. I'll be gladly to share with you. Apostle Paul said, I'm ready. He's talking about an offering. He said, and it's kind of an interesting comparison here. I'm being poured as a drink offering before the Lord. That means he's making here some, he's comparing us with a vessel. And if you read the Bible in many, many places, the Bible compares us with vessels. You are a vessel. Did you know that you are a vessel? And everything that you put in your life, when you worship God, it becomes, or it should become, an acceptable offering before the Lord. Apostle Paul says, I am being poured out, turnat, ca o jertfă de băutură. I'm being poured out. So you are a vessel. And in this vessel, you put everything you put in becomes an offering. And when you worship God, that stuff inside is being poured as a drink offering before the Lord. Now, because we said, you know, the worship is not about the gift, but it comes from the heart. Your worship or your inside is either clean or dirty. You are what you put inside. If you put dirty things in your mind and in your heart and your mind will be dirty. And Apostle Paul says, after I lived my life the best as I could, I'm being ready to be poured as an offering before the Lord. Now, what would you think? So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to prepare a drink, okay? I'm going to pour a little bit of Coke in here. Huh? Pepsi. You guys make me thirsty, man. Pepsi. Can you guys tell the difference between Coke and Pepsi? Yeah, okay. Pepsi. So I'm preparing a drink offering for you. All right. Now, what would you think? All right. I'm going to use a glove here because I want to. What would you think if I put some things in it to make it taste better? I brought some things with me. I don't know if you can see it. I have here a bunch of dead flies. You know, but the Bible talks about dead flies. It said that dead flies spoil the food, right? Muste le morte. That's a little too. But so I'm just going to, don't worry, they're small. They're dead. You won't even see them. You won't even know they're there. There's about five of them. All right. So let me continue my, I got here some maggots. I don't know if you can see it. The Bible talks about dead flies. The Bible talks about, maggots represent death. Verimi sure, you know, vermele nu moare, you know that scripture. Don't worry, they're small. All right. Next, I got some cockroaches. I went to the pet store before I came from Chicago, and I don't even think they're cockroaches. They're those things they feed to snakes and frogs. Crickets! All right. We're preparing a good drink. I'm just going to add it in here. Don't worry, they're small. You won't even know they're there. And lastly, I got some worms. Good, good. Good, very good. We're preparing a drink here. Now, we're going to put a little spin to it to kind of make everything look. It's not even there. It's all gone. It's all good. It's all small. You don't see it anymore, okay? All right. Anybody loves Pepsi? No, wait. Pepsi? Anybody? There's always a bold guy somewhere in there says, yeah, man. You want to? No. I won't let you do it. All right, listen. Some of us come before the Lord in worship. I can take this off now. Apostle Paul said, I'm being ready to be poured as a drink offering before the Lord. You are a vessel. Everything you put in your life affects your life. You are what you put in your heart and in your mind. Sometimes we put little things. And sometimes we put a big spin in our life. And we think that if we spin it fast enough, nobody will know. And then we come to church and say, God, here's my worship. Won't you come and drink? Now listen to me. God knows what's inside. God knows what's inside your heart and inside your mind. Those little dead flies that spoil the food. Those little maggots, little symbols of death that you're playing with. Your worms are in your cockroaches and your dirty stuff. It's all mixed in there, and it's inside, and you're spinning around so fast you think speed is going to make it hide. It's going to make it go away. It's not there. It's all decomposed. It's not even there, Lord. Would you have a drink of my life? I'm going to go and worship you, Lord, now. I'm going to worship you. I'm being ready to be poured out as a drink offering. My question for you young people tonight is, and listen, I didn't do this just for show. And I know I read many verses. I always try to read a lot of Bible verses. But I know that we're busy and many times we forget these verses. And I hope that you will go home and remember, not me and not my sermon, but remember that you are a vessel, and what you put in your life becomes your worship. And you say, God, here's a drink. And God says, I know what's inside. I don't receive that stuff. I don't drink that stuff. So I have a question for you tonight in closing. What are you mixing in your life? What are you mixing in your life? I know there's some good stuff. And I know that here most of it was the good Pepsi. I know that most of you, all of you have, and your life is full of gifts that God has given you, God has blessed you with. But I'm asking you tonight, what are you mixing in your life? What are you adding there that's not according to God, that's not pleasing to God, and makes it, listen, God hates mixture. He hates mixture. He hates a mixture between cold and hot. It's called what? Lukewarm. And God says, because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. I'm not going to drink you. I'm not going to have you because you're a mixture. And I hate mixture, he says. God hates a mixture between black and white. God hates gray. In the Bible, it says in the Garden of Eden, God planted a tree. It was the tree that was forbidden to Adam and Eve. It was called the tree of knowledge of what? Good and evil. God hates that mixture. Nu-i plac amestecăturile. Ce amesteci în viața ta? Știu că majoritatea lucrurilor care sunt în viața ta sunt bune. Dar mai sunt acolo lucruri mici, little things that spoil the drink and makes it unacceptable to God. Or all the little dead flies, the little maggots in your life. Worship has to be acceptable. Paul said, for I am ready to be poured out as a blessing. So my question is, are you ready? You got to be ready. Are you ready? What are you mixing in your life? I like the worship band to come back up on the stage. You know, if we would all be honest tonight, some of the band members, or in our church service, some of the band members would think twice before they go up and worship. They would probably repent first. Some of the preachers should repent first before they worship through teaching. Some of the missionaries before they go on to missions. And again, I'm not preaching works here. I know we are saved by grace. But God is expecting from us a pure sacrifice. Let's all stand together. I'd like to pray before we continue in worship. And I want all of you to bow your heads with me. Father God, We thank you so much tonight for sending your Son Jesus Christ to die for our sins. And through his blood and his sacrifice, we are saved tonight. It's not about our works, and it's not about our good behavior. It's not about something that we did or we do or we will ever do. We are all saved by grace and by the blood of Jesus Christ. But now that we are saved, you are calling us to worship you. And we've learned tonight that there are so many ways to worship, so many other ways to worship besides music. And Lord God, we also learned that you look at the worshiper also. You look at the heart. You look at what's inside. You look at what's inside the heart, Lord God, and that's how you receive it. I pray for these young people, wherever they come from, Lord God. Some of them are worshiping you in the local churches, Lord God, in different departments. Some of them may be Sunday school teachers or working in other departments, Lord, and bringing you constant worship through their work, Lord God. Lord, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you wash us clean of our every sin, everything that's dirty in our lives, Lord. Hallelujah. We learn from your word that if we pray and we ask for forgiveness, you are ready to forgive us. None of us are worthy tonight, and all of us need forgiveness. So we're going to come and pray for forgiveness all together. We're going to worship you tonight through the songs, but it's going to be more than just songs. We want to pray first that you forgive us of our sins and wash us again through the blood of Jesus. In the blood of Jesus, we can receive forgiveness. Lord, if there's someone in here tonight that needs salvation, please speak to them and let them know that it is not by works nor by power, but it's by the sacrifice of Jesus, by the sacrifice of Jesus that we receive salvation. Those of us who are saved, Lord God, we know that you're calling us to a holy life. If you are here tonight and the Lord has spoken to you and you are doing ministry in any way in your church, back home where you come from, and you know that God is calling you to a higher place, and you know that you need forgiveness for some little thing that's there in your life mixed up with the good things, we ask you to come forward and we're going to be praying with you. I'll be praying myself that the Lord cleanses me. And I'll be praying for you together with the other ministers and pastors that the Lord cleanses you of the little things, of the little things that you may be mixing in your offering that are not pleasing to God. So we want to ask you to come forward for prayer. We're going to pray with you. Hallelujah. Let's go and worship before the Lord. Let's worship before the Lord in the spirit and in truth. Hallelujah.